impart strength to my fainting heart, my zeal inspire, as thou hast died for me. Be a living fire. When ends life's transient dreams, when death's cold sullen stream shall Savior, then in love, fear and distrust remove. Oh, bear me safe above a ransomed soul. Grace,
mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Hello, Emmanuel Lutheran Ministries, and all of those of you who are joining us online through our YouTube channel. We thank you for being with us today, and we pray that God would bless you during this time of worship. Today, we are continuing our sermon series all about the great I Ams, where Jesus, especially in the Gospel of John, said to his disciples and the people around him, I am the light of the world, I am the vine, all of these different I am statements. And one of the things that is important for us to remember is that when Jesus is saying this, he is communicating something extremely important. And that is that when he says, I am like that, he's basically telegraphing to the people that he's the one who was speaking to Moses in the burning bush just before the Exodus, in the book of Exodus. And when Moses said, well, when you send me to the people and they ask me what your name is, God says, tell them, I am, has sent you. And this is one of the reasons many of the people of Israel wanted to pick up rocks and throw them at Jesus, because they thought he was being blasphemous. Blasphemy, one of the aspects of blasphemy is claiming that you're God. And that's exactly what Jesus is doing by saying, I am. I am the I am of the Old Testament. And they thought he was blaspheming and pick up stones to stone him to death, because that was the consequence for blasphemy. That was the sentence of death. And so all throughout these moments in the Gospel of John where Jesus says, I am, of course, he's giving us something so much more. The light of the world, the vine, all of these different things. I am the good shepherd. But at the same time, he's reminding us so wonderfully, he is God. God has come down from heaven and put on human flesh so that he could live our life perfectly on our behalf and substitute his perfect living for our imperfect living. And that's what redemption and salvation and forgiveness is all about. And so today, we are looking specifically at how Jesus is the vine. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. And it comes from the Gospel of John chapter 15, beginning at verse 1, and we'll go through verse 8. So if you have your Bibles with you today, turn to John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. And here's what Jesus says. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch of mine that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. Certainly this is the gospel of the Lord, and we can say to that, thanks be to God. As I look at this passage for today, it brings a number of things into my mind. I think most importantly of all is how much we people crave connection. We really do. We're connected, or we try to be connected in so many different ways. Many of us try to connect with other people around a meal, but I think even more so in our social society, we have the connection of Facebook and Twitter, and there's so many different social apps, and the only reason I can think of that they're so popular is because we are a people that crave connection. And there's no doubt at all that there's a very important reason for that. Just recently had the humble honor to serve as pastor for 3 funerals in 1 week. And one of the things that I mentioned in the sermons at all of the funerals, which I believe is very important when we're talking about someone who is a believer who has passed away, is how we as followers of Jesus bear the image of God. The scriptures share this with us in a number of different ways, but the Bible makes it clear that God's people bear God's image. In other words, and this is what I kind of said at the funeral, is that when you see the different gifts and abilities and personalities that the people at the funeral were remembering that day of their loved one who is now with Jesus, you so often see the attributes of God reflected in the life of that person. So, of course, each funeral sermon was different because they were different people. But nevertheless, one of the things that was the same through all of the sermons is that each of those people, and this includes you as well, we are made in the image of God. We reflect many of his attributes, obviously not all of his attributes. And I say this a lot in my sermons, and so this may sound repetitive, but the good news about the Bible is that God repeats himself very often. It seems that God understands for our humanity that repetition is extremely necessary and important. And so I sometimes repeat these things in my sermons, but I think they're so important, and the repetition helps us to remember them. But you are made in the image of God, and that means that you reflect, in many ways, different attributes of God. And not all of them. You know, we're not almighty. We can't create something from out of nothing like God did when he created the universe. But so much of the nature of God has been placed into his creation, and we reflect that. And one thing that's very true about God is that God is a God of relationships. That's why he created us. He wanted a people through which he could be in a relationship himself, connected to. And so, because God is a God of relationship, you know, the Bible tells us God is love. Well, you got to have something to love, right? And that's why he created the universe. And so, because God is a God of connection, God is a God of relationship, humanity is as well. It's one of the reasons we see the connection of relationships with marriage and children and family. All of those are beautiful aspects of God's desire for relationship in our lives, his nature of being a relational God. And we see that so wonderfully here in our gospel lesson for today. We see that God has made us for relationship. He's made us to be connected, not only to him, that's the most important connection, but also to be connected to other people. And that's what Jesus bears out in this reading for today, in this text, that he is the vine, we are the branches. Now, what's great about this text is that God says, or Jesus says, or Jesus is God. Both of those are right, yeah? But Jesus tells us some amazing things. And there's some deep stuff going on here today, so I just want to talk about that. But as we talk about it, think about it from the standpoint of connection and relationship, because that's really where Jesus is going today. And he starts off, he says, I am the true vine, my Father is the vine dresser, and every branch of mine that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And he goes on later on to say that to be connected to him means that we're going to bear a lot of fruit. And so part of what Jesus is saying is, and think in terms of horticulture, think in terms of vines and branches. But anytime you find a tree or a vine or a bush that you cut a branch off of, what happens to the branch? Jesus tells us here, it withers and dies. In other words, what Jesus is saying is that when we're not connected to him, when we're not connected to the vine, the result of that is death. And I think in many ways this goes back to the Garden of Eden. That when God created us, he made it very clear that it was that when we were connected to him, that we would have life. In other words, God is the source of life, and the way in which we live is to be connected to him. Well, the problem with sin, when sin came into the world, is that it separated us from God. It separated us from the source of life. And when you're separated from the source of life, well, all of a sudden, the wage of sin is death. And that's exactly what Jesus is saying here, is that when the branches aren't connected to the vine, think about what a vine does. A vine is what has the roots into the ground. And the roots are what go into the ground and soak up all the nutrients and soak up all the water and the food and everything so that the branches can grow, so that the branches can bear fruit. And when you're cut off from that source, when you're cut off from the roots, when you're cut off from the vine, there's no way for you to live. You wither, you die, and he says, in no uncertain terms, the dead branches are gathered, they're collected, they're thrown in the fire, and they're burned. That's some pretty powerful and frightening judgment language there that Jesus is reminding us of. And so to have life, to have abundant life, and to bear fruit is to be connected to the vine. And Jesus says, that's me. So for humanity, the way that we truly have life is to be connected to Jesus. Now, Jesus goes on and says there's some great things that happen when you're connected to him. And that is you bear much fruit. And God's kingdom is very much about bearing fruit. In other words, that there's some good things that happen in your life as a result of being connected to Jesus. We might also call this good works. Now, we want to make sure that we put the good works in the right place, right? Jesus tells us, and not just Jesus, but God has said throughout the scripture, especially if you read in the book of Galatians, he used Paul to remind us that no one is saved by what we do. We're not saved by works. We're saved by grace through faith. Ephesians says this as well. We're saved by grace through faith apart from works so that no one can boast. But the fruit that we bear, the good works that we do as branches connected to the vine, are still going to be a part of our lives. So we have to understand what the balance is between being connected to the vine and bearing fruit. Because what we don't want to do is turn the fruit into a source of salvation. And Jesus even says that here, right? He goes on and he says that already, just a couple lines in, already you are clean because of the word that you have spoken to me. So Jesus is making it very clear to us that we are clean, not by what we do, not by the fruit that we bear, but by his word. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. It is God's word that cleanses us and washes us and forgives us of all of our sins. In fact, it's God's word that connects us back to the vine. Remember in the Garden of Eden, when sin came into the world, we were separated from God. We were branches that were cut off. And what God does when he cleanses us, when he washes us, is he grafts us back into the vine. I don't know if you've ever heard of grafting, but grafting is where you can take a branch and actually cut a hole in the vine and put the branch back in, and it starts to live again. It starts to bear and grow fruit again. That's what grafting is. And God has taken us and grafted us back into the vine. And he says he does that by the power of his word. The word of God is what makes us clean. The word of God is what reconnects us to the vine. And so we have to remember that. The fruit that we bear, the good works that we do, don't save us. They are the result of being saved. And that's a very important distinction, because we don't want to turn our salvation into what we do. We don't want to become the God of our own salvation. God is the God of our salvation, not us. And so the minute we start talking about our works saving us, we become God, and that's a real problem. That's a no-go there. And so Jesus says it very clearly, already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. But here's what's amazing. Because of that cleansing forgiveness, because God has reconnected us with the vine, Jesus Christ, he goes on to say that there's going to be some amazing results. He says, if anyone does not abide in me, he's thrown away. And we get that part. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire. But if you abide in me, and my words abide in you. See, it still goes back to the word of God there. Notice that. That's very important. It always goes back to the word of God. That's the power of God unto salvation, right? I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's another way of saying I'm not ashamed of the word of God, because it's the power of God unto salvation. Paul tells us that. So if my words abide in you, the same word that cleansed you, the same word that washed you, okay? You can ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this, my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. So the good works that we do, the fruit that we bear in our lives, is the result of God's word, is the result of being connected to the vine. In other words, God works in us. He works through us. He works for us. And that's what Jesus is saying here. In fact, Jesus even says at one point, apart from me, you can do nothing. Now think about that for a minute. When you're thinking in terms of bearing fruit, when you're thinking in terms of good works, apart from Jesus, you can do nothing. We see people do good works all the time, you know, give $1 million to a charity, whatever it may be. But here's the thing. When people do good works that are not connected to the vine of Jesus Christ, when it comes to Jesus, when it comes to the kingdom, they don't count as good works. They may look very good in the world, and they may do good things. There's no doubt about that. They can still have good repercussions. But from a kingdom standpoint, they don't have any kingdom value, because they weren't the result of Christ working in us and through us. You know, I recently read a meme that I thought was very appropriate for this sermon. It was a meme that was a quote of St. Augustine. And St. Augustine said, Lord, the good I do is because of you. Everything else is my fault. And you know, that's so true. That's what Jesus is saying here. Apart from him, we can do nothing. So even our fruit, even our good works, are the result of God working in us and through us. They're the result of being connected to the vine, which, by the way, is why they cannot save us. Our good works can't save us, because you have to already be saved to produce good works. That's what Jesus is saying here. So, but why does God do it? Why does God want us to bear much fruit in our lives? What does it mean to bear fruit? Well, I think in the most simplest of terms, to bear fruit is when we love and serve our neighbor. When we share the good news of Jesus, when we bless the neighbors, the people around us, when our eyes are open to how God needs us to serve among the people who live in our lives. And that's exactly what Jesus says here. He says, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. In other words, Jesus is saying that this is what discipleship is. Discipleship is when God uses us to bless the people around us. He says it already. You're already clean. You've already been blessed. That's the good news of the gospel. You've already been grafted back into the vine. And God is working in you and through you to keep you clean, to constantly bring you to repentance for the forgiveness of sins, to constantly keep you grafted into the vine for your salvation. But because you're in the vine, because you are saved, because you are cleansed, God wants to use you for the sake of those who are around you, for the sake of those who are not yet a part of his kingdom. Remember, God wants everyone to be saved, and he's invited us to make disciples of all nations. And so the way he does that is by bringing fruit or works forth in our lives. And the works that he wants to bring forth in our lives, they do two things. Number one, they proclaim the goodness of God to the people around us so that they may hear and by God's grace believe, that they may be grafted into the vine, that they may be cleansed, that they may know what it means to have a Savior in Jesus Christ. But the other thing that it does is it glorifies God. That's what he says here. It's so beautiful. God brings forth fruit in our lives to bring glory to his name, but also to share his grace, his love, the same grace that has been given to you because you're grafted into the vine, the same cleansing that you have because of Jesus' words. God wants to share through you to others. He wants you and me to go make disciples of all nations. And so Jesus says it here. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. Jesus says, I am the vine. He is the source. He is the root. He is the nutrient. He cleanses. He grows. He produces everything, which is why God gets the glory. But he has a goal in mind. He has a purpose for all of that. Not only to save us, to save you, to save me, to shower upon us his promises of life everlasting, but also so that he would use you, that he would use me to share that goodness, to share the gospel of Jesus, the grace of God, with anyone and everyone you may happen to meet. My prayer is that God would grant that in your life and in mine for Jesus' sake. Amen. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you so much that salvation is not something we have to do. Because if that were true, we know we would mess it up. But since you are the one who works salvation in our lives, since it's your word that cleanses us, we can trust that your salvation is sure. We thank you that you're willing to graft us back into the vine, that you're willing to wash us and cleanse us, and that you want to use us. We know we don't deserve that, but that's what makes you so good and kind and loving. And so we humbly pray, Lord, that as you continue to work your grace in our lives, that you would use us to share the gospel, to share the grace of God with anyone and everyone that we meet. This we pray in the name of Jesus, our one and only Savior, and all God's people said, Amen. You know, we also have been taking a moment to put together some testimonial videos about how God's grace works and in the lives of the people here at Emmanuel Lutheran Ministries. And up next, our video is going to be Rosella and Larry Smith. And they have a great story about how God uses them to bring the good news of Jesus into the lives of their foster kids. And so we encourage you to take a listen and see how God has been working in them and through them. Have a great day.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Rosella Smith, and this is my husband, Larry Smith. I grew up in Indiana in a Christian family. We went to church every week. My dad was a Sunday school teacher, superintendent. I accepted the Lord at a young age. We got married. We had three children and had a Christian household. But eventually my three sons decided to grow up and fly the coop. So Larry and I were empty nesters. So about 7 years ago, we decided to become foster parents. It had been something that we'd thought about but never had done. But we were couch potatoes, basically, so we decided it was time. So we took the classes with CPS, and that started our six-year journey of being foster parents, sharing what a normal life is for the foster kids and taking them to church and sharing Jesus with them.
First of all, I'm from Arizona, and my parents were in the military. That's where they met, in Port Huachuca, where I was born. They were both involved in the church, but we were in the military, which is a little bit different than it is in the civilian sector. That kind of environment where we went to, us kids went to mass as well as church, catechism as well as Sunday school. We decided to be Lutherans as more or less, I felt like I was going to church, you know, or mass, or you know, what I'm used to. Doing foster care, we kind of introduced kids. We really didn't make it a big deal. We just went to church. This usually gave them an opportunity to see people that they otherwise would not get to see, because in school they get exposure and things like that, but outside of that it's rather restrictive. So having the opportunity of taking them to Sunday school and to church, sometimes it enables them to meet people that they would otherwise, other kids that they would not otherwise get to meet, and have a positive influence as that.
And has that changed any of the lives of some of your foster kids?
We don't get much exposure to them after they leave us. They're usually with us for about a year. But as far as we can see, there's been great things. In other words, I know that of one that remembers Sebastian. And he really had mixed feelings about leaving. So it's the objective, the way we approach things is that we're basically, their parents have gotten a time out to go and get things back together, to because it's not a child's fault where they're at. And we've always been looked at this as something we can extend to them as far as our family and what we can do for them in addition. And we really never went in from this, I'm going to get so bonded to this that I'm going to get this. The objective here is to get them back with their family where they belong and take care of them.
And you have an opportunity to send them with the light of Jesus.
Absolutely. Yeah. And a good portion of them haven't been exposed. Most of them have in some way or another. It's pretty hard not to.
But we also adopted a 17-year-old Kristen, who many of you remember, and she actually was able to reunite with her biological mother. She is in Beaumont now, and she's married and working, and she is a normal individual now, and I think she really enjoys having had us as adoptive parents. We've also had some that have gone on. Some may remember Alexis, and we're friends on Facebook, and she has also been happily adopted, as far as we know. And some of them have been, a lot of the children have been reunited with family members. If not, some have actually been adopted by other individuals. So we think that we made a difference in the lives of several children.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopeless always hungry.